Hi everyone. I'm actually starting a little bit early today so I can get everything set up right. I'm gonna be putting this together right now, so just bear with me. Here we go. Hi everyone, Robert Grant here. I'm just starting a little bit early today so I can get everything set up correctly, but just bear with me. I'm trying to get all these running two different platforms at the same time, but good to see everyone today. Okay. Hi, everyone. Good to have you here today. Just trying to get everything set up so I can watch this all correctly and make sure that this is all showing up as well as possible. Now, it's showing up totally clear on my screen here, but for some reason, I'm trying to watch it on Facebook, and it's not giving me a totally clear screen. So I'm just trying to see what everyone is experiencing. I'm also on Instagram. Today we're starting a little bit differently, but first, before I go into the discussion about today, I'm going to show you, here's another option instead of using a compass. If you don't have a compass because you're stuck on quarantine or whatever, there are a lot of different ways to make circles. You can make circles using one of these frames, or you can make circles using coasters for drinks and stuff. And that seems to work pretty well too. So that's basically the first thing. And there's lots of places you can buy those kind of frames at art stores. Sometimes you'll find them even at drugstores. I had still a lot of questions yesterday about the ruler that I'm using. You know, what type of ruler do I use? And in this particular case, it is the Westcott ruler. And it's a fabulous ruler, love it. One thing I wanna mention is that after a while, it starts to pick up a lot of lead, et cetera, from whatever it is you're using it with. And so you kind of have to wash this off after a few days of usage. Otherwise, it starts to drag a lot of that stuff along the paper, and that's not something that you really want. So that's that. So now, the first thing I wanted to show you today is this prime number pattern. Let's see if I can get this hopefully a little bit more clear for everybody to be able to see. Now, this is the prime number pattern, and the prime number pattern that I published on, and this is the actual original notebook that I drew it all on as well. So these are the primes, and all of the prime numbers that you can see here are the numbers that are in the orange color, and all of the green numbers are what's known as quasi-primes now. And that has been a discovery that we published on, myself and Talal Gwanam. And basically we published on that because it allowed us, the discovery of quasi-primes allowed us to predict infinite and accurate prime numbers. Now, we're looking at this in a two-dimensional view, but this is creating a spiral from center of 24. So it goes out in what's called a mod 24 analysis. So there would be 24 spokes on this. And on each of the spokes, the prime numbers already show up. So that's not exactly that novel, because prime numbers are known to be multiples of 6 plus or minus 1, with the exception of 2 and 3. But what was novel was the discovery of the quasi-primes, which then allowed us to create an exclusion criteria so that we could predict primes infinitely. Because we could generate the green numbers, every number that is either green in each spoke, it's either green or orange without exception, and every number that is generated green then leaves an exclusion for all numbers that are not green, which then means the prime numbers are what's left over. And then you can predict them accurately and infinitely without exception. So that was a kind of a big deal for us when we discovered it. And what's interesting about that in particular is that the structure of that particular geometry is this, which is called the cube octahedron. So the cube octahedron is the structure that is associated with this particular geometry, but in three dimensions. So in two dimensions, it's called an icosi tetragon, or 24-sided polygon. But in three dimensions, it would be the cube octahedron, which is an Archimedean solid. And it happens to have 24 edges. So imagine that 24 spiral, basically, that we just saw in two dimensions. Each of the spokes are represented by the edges of this cube octahedron right here. And each of those is determined by different mathematical constants. Now, the cube octahedron is also unique in that it has three sides and then four sides. And this also relates to pi, because it has one adjacent side between the triangle and the square. So that means 3, 1, 4. Now, do you recognize that number? 3.14. That's pi. That's exactly pi. That's how we make circles from diameters, right? So this is a balanced structure. Now, the other thing that's interesting to note about this is that the cube octahedron is the only geometry that exists that you could draw a point from center to each one of the vertices, and it will be the exact same length to no matter what vertice you're pointing it to. So that's why it's also called the vector equilibrium. And this is a very important type of structure as a result of that. So we're going to learn how to draw this today. And, the Archimedean solids aren't known to be something that you can draw out of what's called Metatron's cube, which we've been learning from. But I'm going to show you how you actually can. So here we go. So, all right, so we're going to start off with our ruler again. And let's wipe off our page here, nice and clean. And hopefully we can all see this pretty well. Okay. I'm going to find the middle point here. I'll draw a line down the center. Be very careful. Do this correctly. And then to cut across here. There we go. Now, one thing I want to do real quick. 1 second. Trying to get our music up here. So let's go back. Okay, here we go. Hopefully we can all see this. Okay. So let's draw the cube octahedron. So I'm going to draw this with a 4-inch radius. So I'm measuring this on my ruler. So it's exactly 4 inches. And I've used a darker lead so people can hopefully see it better. Okay. Now, as we learned yesterday, the simple thing, to find the Merkaba. So I'm going to start at the bottom here, mark this here, mark this here. Okay. Now, I'm really grateful that many of you actually have started doing your pictures of your different drawings of geometry, and you've been posting it online, and I'm impressed. You guys have done a great job. Really wonderful stuff. And so if you post on your output on this, I'll repost it for you as well from my site, as I already have done with several people. So I'm drawing the female triangle that's pointed down. Now this morning, I had a really nice meditation outside looking at the sunrise. It was fantastic today. Trying to go a little slower today. Some people said I was going really fast yesterday. Felt slow for me. But once you get used to this, you don't even really have to think much about it. Okay. So we'll do a little review on the things that we've learned already. Okay. So we're going to go to... Remember, these angles right here are 60 degrees, 60 and 60. Now I need to make a 36 degree angle here, which will be important as we come back to it here in a moment. And that creates the arms of a pentagram. And I just go around the circle to do this. It gives me these framing lines. Very simple. Right now I'm going to the next one. And today's music is Beethoven, by the way. Okay. Thanks for bearing with me also, as I'm still trying to learn how to use all these different technologies. I've never really done Instagram Live before until this past week, and never done Facebook Live either. Never had the time to do it, I guess. So here's gratitude for small blessings. So now we're getting close to being done here with this octachoron that's right at the center. The octachoron polytope, that's a name that I gave this. And that's what these two hypercubes are right in here. Here's a cube. Hypercubes. Okay. So we learned, and I'm going to do this with some colors, I think, to help people make some differentiation today. So I'll use purple, and I'm going to use blue and maybe red here. So let's draw our dodecahedron with purple. So we learned the dodecahedron this last time, and everyone did a really nice job. Those that drew it did a really nice job of getting it perfectly. I was impressed. Not bad for the first few times. Now, a little harder with pen, because if you make a mistake, it's a lot less forgiving. But so that people can see and differentiate, I'm going to do this today. I hope you're getting the benefits of doing this kind of work and how it can put you in a really relaxed state. Very similar to meditation, but it doesn't replace meditation. I think it supplements it. There's a beautiful cello playing here in the background also, don't we? Okay, let's draw the pentagon here. You guys are all going to be expert at drawing this stuff very, very shortly. I was impressed. One of the people from Australia posted something and said, you know, wow, only learned this in a day. Imagine what happens if I do this for a year. Well, hopefully our quarantine doesn't last for a year. That's for sure. So here we go. Notice these are all pentagons. They're all showing up in here. I'm drawing it with my purple pen. Try to be very careful, because if I make a mistake, there's no erasing with this thing. Okay, so there we have the dodecahedron, and very nice. Let's draw another thing inside this as well. Let's put inside of here a tetrahedron. Put this in red. The purple lines play the center lines of the tetrahedron. So now look, we have a dodecahedron, we have a tetrahedron, and it wouldn't take much for me now to turn this into an icosahedron, which, by the way, I didn't realize this yesterday when I chose the icosahedron as being the geometry that we were going to focus on for the day. And actually, what I later learned was that yesterday was the International Day for Water. So what a cool coincidence is that? I had no idea. And the icosahedron represents water, as we talked about yesterday. So that was pretty cool. I'm really happy that that turned out the way that that did. Now, I can take this and turn this, of course, into the icosahedron. And the icosahedron structure that we talked about yesterday is quite easy to do, but we need to now put this into a three-dimensional structure, so we're gonna have to have it a bit larger. So I'm gonna use a different color. Let's use blue for that. Now, theoretically, I could use that one at the center, but I don't think I'm going to, because if I do, then you'll confuse it with the tetrahedron or also the structure of the dodecahedron. So I'm going to draw this on the outside here. I'm going to make a larger hexagon. I'm doing this in blue. Being very careful, because if I make a mistake with these pens, it's not going to be forgiving. Which I guess in a way helps me go a bit slower than I normally would. So now, I'm going to start with a center triangle. You know, most of this, when you learn how to use Metatron's Cube, it really is about learning how to connect the dots. Got my nice icosahedron coming, emerging from this geometry. And of course, whatever I want to emphasize more of, I certainly can. I can put more lines into it to emphasize more significantly the geometries that I want to display. Now we have the icosahedron with the center. And this is also showing us some of the breathing. So if I wanted to go another step higher, I could show the incremental breathing that would show up here, 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 and here. But today we're going to learn how to draw the cube octahedron. So we just did a review of the tetrahedron. We did a review of the dodecahedron. We did a review of the icosahedron. And of course, if I wanted to take this tetrahedron and turn it into one of the, here's a rudimentary form of it. I could draw like this, which is now going to give me the octahedron. And I could add some dimensionality to it just by drawing a line like this. Notice I've got it meeting right here at this point, and then doing this, just like that. See how easy that is? Now that gives me the octahedron, so now I've got all the platonic solids. And I could even have it come to this to give it even greater dimensionality perspective. I could even draw these back lines into it as well, which I'll do in pencil. So now look, we've got all these cool nested geometries right in here. It's in a matter of minutes. Okay, now let's go to the octahedron, or sorry, to the cube octahedron. And let's do the cube octahedron in a brownish color. A little reddish brown. I'll use these two colors for that. Thank you. Okay, so here we go. Now, with the cube octahedron, we actually have to start with our orientation almost at a diagonal, because you have to see where the Merkaba goes inward like this, right? And we're gonna take advantage of that line. And we're just gonna trace right over it. So we have to be careful because these colored pencils will break more easily than regular pencils. Now, this is the universe's system for delineating prime numbers as well as the square roots of all numbers in this cube octahedron structure that comes right out of the Metatron's cube. So that's the first part of it. I'm gonna keep going around, doing that on all sides. Just like that. So I'm basically tracing the hexagram. This is where the brush really comes in handy if you're trying to use different colors on this. Because any of those bits that you leave behind will turn into a smudge when you put your ruler over it. So you want to be very deliberate about wiping them away. So it doesn't cause you a pain later and a mess. Also, as these pencils tend to wear down faster, you have to sharpen them more. Cube octahedron is very, very special because what it's doing is it's pulling together pi from the square root of 2 and the square root of 3. Now, the square roots of numbers are actually what makes the numbers, if you could think of it like that. Now I'm going to do something a little different, and I'm going to cross these intersections here. I'm going to do this with pencil. Do it on the other side. If you're careful to line this line up, therefore you're gonna know you're gonna draw something relatively straight, if not perfectly straight, which is really important when you're doing geometry. I'm just gonna keep going around. See here, I can line up this line cutting across here, right? And usually I like to use the thinner lines rather than the thicker ones because that gives me greater exactness. And geometry is about bringing to manifestation the deliberate nature of the geometry itself. It's like creating a flower, making a flower. See, what that's doing is it's actually making another structure inside these as well. Give me another Merkaba inside larger ones. So this is another way to do nesting as well. Nature does all the nesting for you. You don't have to worry about it. That's the beauty of it. So now I've drawn these lines. I can just go lightly over them. I don't have to worry too much about making it absolutely perfect. Remember, mistakes are good. Life gives us some errors sometimes, and I think they're there for our own benefit. In fact, if I look back on my life, I'm probably at least, if not more, grateful for the big mistakes I've made in my life, because that's what came along with the learning. And the only thing you can take with you when you go to the next life, probably, is what you learned. There's no possessions, there's no materialism. That stuff just doesn't matter. The relationships that you had, people you've loved, the learnings you took with you, that's what's valuable. Okay, so here we have cube octahedron now that just came out of this without even really thinking much about it. Now look at this. Now all it takes is a different perspective to see this. What was the icosahedron has now just become the cube octahedron. I'm being deliberate to draw inside the blue line so I can show that this was very, very thoughtful. It wasn't by accident. Okay. Isn't that interesting? Now I've got a beautiful cube octahedron. Now, let me go ahead and try to frame this better for you. And I'm going to give it some extra lines with this other... use the red color. Okay, so now I'm gonna go ahead and do like I did yesterday. Give it some extra perspective and dimension. This is probably for some of you when you're going to start seeing this geometry come to life. It's a trick of the brain, how we interpret things. You know, 90% of what happens to us in life is how we interpret what actually happened to us and not what actually occurred. Imagine there's geometry right in front of our noses, just like this, that we can see, but only if we have the eyes to see it. And you'll never see it if you don't know what you're looking for. But yesterday I discovered a new geometry. I did the day before too. And I'll share one of them with you today. And every time I discover a new geometry, I find that I see the world differently from that moment forward. It expands my perception, changes how I look at things. Just as this coronavirus has probably forced several of us, it's only been a week or so quarantine, but it's forced several of us already to start perceiving the world around us differently. Maybe some of the things that we took for granted before, we're not taking for granted anymore. Maybe we experience a different reality than the one we're used to in our day-to-day lives because of what's happened with coronavirus. And I see all of that as ultimately consciousness expanding. So here's our square, here's our triangle, and it's in perspective and in dimensional perspective. So I'm just going to keep going around and drawing this nice little frame so that I can color it if I want. Post it for you guys. Now, I've been posting the results of these drawing sessions so everyone can see what gets made here in this very short amount of time. Now, if you have little edges like this, you can make it much more challenging. See, this is getting pretty dull, so I gotta sharpen it up again. Ugh. Now that happens a lot too with these. And I have not found a pencil that doesn't happen to. But remember, these are made of some sort of wax material. So they get pretty soft. If you press down too hard on it, you can break it right away, just like I just did. So try to be careful that you don't do that. Don't make the mistakes I did. So now you can see this cube octahedron coming to life. This is one of the most important geometries. In fact, it is the center thesis of the Archimedean solids, which are 13 solids. And this sits right at the center, the basic structures of a triangle, merging up against a triangle, merging up against a square. And out of this comes pi. So that leads me to ask the question, well, if pi is a mathematical constant that's coming out of this, then shouldn't there also be a mathematical constant that relates to 4.15? And the answer is yes, there is. And isn't there then a mathematical constant that should relate to 5.16? And in fact, yes, there is. And then shouldn't there then be one at 6.17? And in fact, yes, there is. Shouldn't there also be one at 7.18? Yes, there is. And 8.19? Yes. 2.13? Yes, indeed. Those are all mathematical constants, some of which we have discovered because we knew where to look. For those that are wondering, this is Vivaldi, Four Seasons. Okay, so now we have a cube octahedron, and I could color that to make it come out easier for you, but you know what? I'm gonna take, see, this is the problem with doing this with pen. It will smudge every time, so you have to be really, really careful when you're gonna go to erase. You have to take a lot of time in between. So I just wanted to be able to show people today the best that I could show using color, because I know that some people were upset, or not upset, but wanting to see greater differentiation of the coloration and also just be able to see it all together. So I'm watching it right now also on my computer screen on Facebook, and it looks like it's relatively clear. So that's not too shabby. So now let's talk about this for a moment. And this notion of, I'll do a different page so I don't have to mess this up. I'm actually thinking about putting all of these pieces of art that we do during the coronavirus days into art that I might actually sell, because I don't generally sell my art, might sell for charity to the, and have the proceeds go to the families of people that that are local, that are victims of this coronavirus outbreak. So let's talk a little bit about the mathematics of pi. So someone asked me yesterday, what is the importance, or what are the most important mathematical constants or ratios? Now, pi is certainly one, right? And we all know what that does, right? So if I were to start with a diameter, and let's draw this diameter of 4 inches. Right? And if I were to multiply that by 4, right, that will give me the circumference. Of the circle, right? So then that means that I would have a radius of 2, right? So I would have to mark this at the center. And that means that this will have a circumference of pi times 4. And that's going to be something around, you know, 12 and a half, in that zone will be the circumference of this circle with a radius of 2. So the r equals 2 and the d equals 4. Yeah, you might say, well, why are you even bothering to use inches in this? Don't people use metric in most places in the world? Well, actually, as I said, if we can assume that 3.14, right, is a very important mathematical constant, then 4.15 should also be, which would then be a structure that is squares in geometry that would be merging into pentagons, right? So here's your 4, here's your 5, and here is the 1. Okay, well then, if that's the case, then what about 5.16? And 5.16 would look like this. So there's my 5. I'm going to use the exact same side length. Six. Now, I mentioned this on the first call, but this has a counterbalance because it's actually a boundary condition around the number three. So the number three sits right here up at the center. And just think of this as geometry as well. And on one side over here, we've got pi. And then on the other side, we've got Euler, which is 2.71828818. So you've got pi, 3.1415926. And one of the things that I discovered was that if I multiply this in a weighted average fashion, which is representative of the exact same thing we've just been doing, right? I'm going to take this and I'm going to draw a triangle down the center of this. So it's giving me an equilateral triangle, all sides being equal. Now, the amount of area, right? And if I did this as a sphere versus a tetrahedron, it would be a 1/3 volume versus 2/3 space volume. So then I tried, okay, well, what if I multiply this by 2/3 and I multiply this by 1/3? What does it equal? Well, it equals 3.000. So the Euler number is just a counterbalance. Think of this as a seesaw that is based on the spherical and tetrahedral dimensions of volume. Now, that's very interesting. So then what about 516? Well, let's look what we got here with 516. Now, this is something I discovered over Christmas, that if I drew a circle here at the center and I made its radius exactly 1 foot, so I actually made this exactly equal to 1 inch right here, as you can see. And then I made a exoscribed circle around that and then inscribed a hexagon within that, or exoscribed a hexagon around that circle of 1 foot radius, then the next inscribed circle would come out to exactly 1 cubit. This is the sacred Egyptian cubit that is supposed to be at least 4,500 years old that the Great Pyramid was built off of. So it's 1.718 feet. Now, most people have been taught that the cubit is supposed to be the length from your elbow, right, to your end of your arm. And actually, it's a set value that's directly proportional to the foot. It's just an up fractal outside of it. So you have an inscribed circle, which has a 1 foot radius. You have an exoscribed circle, and then another inscribed circle within the next exoscription of the next hexagon, as you can see. And now it's 1.718 feet. So it's a perfect dimensional reference here between the foot and the cubit. This is thousands of years old. Now, why are we thinking that this is based on just an elbow or some arbitrary measurement of the foot? Also, if I made the circle have a 1 meter radius, then it's 1/12 of the circle or arc of 30 degrees here, 1/12 would be 30 degree arc, would come out to exactly 1.718 feet. So if this was 1 meter right here from here to here, then this would be 1.718 feet. Again, the sacred Egyptian cubit, it's 0.5236 of a meter. Now, if I cut that in half, it comes out to 2618. So that's phi squared for those of you that might recognize that. So then I thought, well, wait a minute. The imperial system is based on sixes and the sexagesimal math system. The decimal system is based on tens and therefore fives. So why don't I put a 5-1-6 relationship and see what happens? Well, surprise, surprise, from this point to the inscribed pentagram inside here comes out to be exactly 1 meter, which is 3.281 feet, 3.2816 feet. So that's interesting. Now, another thing that's interesting is if this were the radius, my 30 degrees of arc on this would take exactly 1 second for a pendulum to swing back and forth, one time for each swing, each direction. So this is kind of a perfect measurement system that we have found is embedded into the building of the Great Pyramid itself. And Alan Green's work on this is astounding, truly astounding. And therefore, we found that 516 is a fundamental a mathematical constant, much like pi, and that the measurement systems themselves are related somehow to these fundamental mathematical constants, because the 1.718 feet of the sacred Egyptian cubit is actually Euler minus 1. So 1 foot becomes the 1. The cubit is Euler minus 1. And then 5 minus Euler minus 1, or the cubit, 6 minus Euler altogether equals the meter. So 6 feet minus Euler number, 2.718, comes out to exactly the meter. Now, what are we missing here, right? Clearly, there's more information here that we have not remembered or not known about, and something more that we should understand about how this works. And to illustrate that further, using 3 dimensions, I did the exact same thing. Found that the exact same ratios persist, starting with the foot, which then becomes the cubit, which then becomes the meter, and then it keeps repeating over and over and over again. The legend here, 1 meter equals 3.2816 feet. Move this a little closer so you can see it better. And then 1 cubit is 1.718 feet, and also 0.5236 meters. So something very special comes as a result of this as well. Because here's the same Merkaba shape, but it would surprise you to possibly know that I can use 6 pentagrams to create exactly the structure of the Merkaba, which is exactly what this is right here. So you can see the shape of the pentagram sitting right inside here. And the peak of these 6 different pentagrams is making a perfect hexagram. So with that, I'll go ahead now and open the time to questions, because I'm sure that probably left us with a few. And we can touch on more of them next time. But I'll leave this picture with you in your mind so that you can think about, okay, now you know how to draw several different geometries. And you can nest these geometries within other geometries. You now have the ability to do all of this that I just showed you. So we have a dodecahedron here. We have a hypercube inside here. We have an icosahedron. We have a Merkaba. And we have a tetrahedron right inside here. And we even have a octahedron sitting inside here as well. So with that, we'll open the time to questions. Let me see what I can do here. I could probably just look here on some of the ones on Facebook because I've got it on my computer screen. Okay, so quite a few comments on here. Let's see. One sees a square. It does come down to all the constants, really. Constants are infinities in finite form for a long time. In a lot of the traditions, they were trying to represent God or divine forms or transcendental reality as forms we could see. Hypershapes can be found in quite a few different texts. Yes, true. Very true. Mesmerizing is why reality exists. It's a bit like lucid dreaming. Only if awareness is active and we are not asleep. That is true. Geometry already enriches our lives and love everywhere. How do you think that we can implement geometry into enriching our lives? I think that's a deep question. I'll probably try to tackle that one for you guys here right now. I think that geometry has enriched my life very substantially. I'll say that. It's kind of amazing how much it's impacted my life. I'm trying to get this thing straight. And, you know, I think that the reason why it's been so powerful in my life has been that it's really helped me to see other perspectives and other viewpoints that I didn't think existed. You know, I'm about to post something that I discovered last night, which is an entirely new geometry. And let's see where I put it here. It's this one right here. And this is a merger of 5 and 6. And you can see here that the triangles that are butting up against each other, this is made solely of triangles that are either equilateral or isosceles triangles. And this is an entirely new geometry that I don't have a name for yet. And it has 108 triangles, therefore 19,440 degrees. It's a totally new discovery. And it's built on the same triangles that are equilaterals merging into this phi triangle, which is 72 degrees, 72 degrees, and 36 degrees. And there's one stopover on this that I've noticed as well, which turns out to be 66 degrees and 66 degrees and 48 degrees in between. So there's one that's like crossing right in between those two degree points, but it's an entirely new geometrical structure based on equilateral triangles and phi triangles. Every time I find a new geometry, it comes along with it, comes an increase in perception and perspective that I didn't otherwise understand or know. And that's one of the things that's really cool about this too. So let's see. Quite a few people on here. And hello from Rio. Hi. Good to see everyone. Oh, please do. Please send me your geometry or post it. And if you post it and tag me, then I will forward it to all of my followers as well. And you may end up with some people that want to follow you, but that's okay. Show off your good work. Really excited about doing this with you guys. And I hope that you're finding that it's having an impact in your life. I thought of all the things that I wanted to be able to do, feeling kind of helpless through this whole coronavirus thing, that maybe teaching geometry would be something people would A, be interested in, and B, hopefully it would help transform their own consciousness and bring them into a different way of feeling empathy, as it has for me. Thank you very much, everyone, and have a wonderful day as best as you can. And we're all in this together, and hope to see you again tomorrow. Bye.